Okay, hi. The background of this talk is that 1.5 years ago I thought I should learn some more about how to set up small embedded C programs on my ARM. So I should write a blog, and then I started, and then I've been working like on and off on that blog post like 20 minutes here and there. And then 3 weeks or 4 weeks ago, I finished it, and I published it, and I tweeted it. And then you were asked, maybe you can report about it. And I was like, okay, so, let's talk about that. So here's the core. So what we're going to talk about, or what I'm going to talk about, is running C programs bare metal on an ARM using the GNU toolchain. And to be more specific, we want to run this program. So it's sort of a minimalistic program, as you can see. So the idea of my blog post and the idea here is to just take a very small C program and sort of reverse engineer our way to what needs to be in place in order to, for this to execute on the processor. So in the past, when I have done this, I often fiddle things together from using Google, how to set it up. But this time, I want to dig in a little bit more into to what is needed. So the idea here is I take my C program, and I convert it into a assembler. And then I start to read it. So I say, why do I need this stuff that I usually need just by reading the assembler code? So this is sort of what we're going to do today. And then at the end, we will end up with a list of prerequisites in order to run this. And we will go through how to fill them. And then in the end, we will run it and we will see if it works. Okay. And here is the process. So we want to run this code on this processor and what do we need to do in order to run it. But I don't want to take too large steps, you know. Okay, so here's our list. At the end of this presentation, we will have some requirements here. So I will fill it up gradually for you. Now it's empty. But we want to start easy. So skip C and start with only assembler. So we want to run this program on this processor. What do we need to do? Okay, so I will start with this. And what does this program do? We have a helper box, it's the blue box up in the corner. We store some values in registers, 3 in register 2, and the value 4 in register 3. And then we sum them up, and we put that result in R4. So that's everything. So we will go through here what we need to put in place in order to execute that. So the first question I'm going to discuss a little bit is what really happens on power on? I have this device here, and when I power it on, it starts to execute, so doing something, and I need to know what. So what happens is that a reset exception. That's what happens. There's many kinds of exceptions that can occur on an ARM device. Like you have, when you push a button, for example, you can have an exception happening, and the software can handle that. But at power on, a very special type of exception happens called reset exception. So we must handle this exception.
How is it different to an interrupt?
It's pretty similar to an interrupt. But they also have different priorities, and this has very high priority,
okay.
Like as high as you can get. Like. But I will show you. So basically, what we need to do is that we need to create something called a vector table that tells the processor how to handle different exceptions, like the reset exception. And what we will do in the vector table is that we will point at another place. please run that code if this happens. If this kind of exception happens, I want you to jump there and start to execute. And so in this case, we need to tell the processor, if a reset happens, just jump there and you go. So we need a vector table, and we need to put it right at the beginning of the flash memory, because there is where the processor will look for it. This is a Cortex M3 that I have been doing this project on. So everything I'm saying is applicable for that one. And there can be differences with other models. Okay. So this can be our vector table. Actually, the vector table can be really long because there are different kinds of exceptions. But since we're doing something really minimalistic here, part of the task for me was also, how minimalistic can I do this? What do I really need to put in there? Because I only want to find, in the end, I only want to do as little as possible just to execute the code I've shown you. I don't want to put anything more in my boilerplate here for other kinds of situations. I'm trying to be minimalistic all the time. So in the vector table we're going to create today, we're only going to work with two things, and those are the top two items in the vector table. First, at address 0, we have something called initial set pointer value. That's the very first thing that the ARM Cortex expects to find at address 0 when you power it on. And at the next position, it expects you to put the pointer to what it should do when a reset exception happens on the address 4. And then there are lots of other exceptions that can happen, but we will not handle those today. There are different kinds of errors, for example, that if you do a real project, you should have error handlers for those. So you do some error handling, but we don't take care of errors here today. We're going for the minimalistic kind of requirements here. Okay, so how do I write a vector table in assembler? If I want to write this vector table in assembler, how do I write it? You can write it like this. You create a section, and we'll talk more about the sections. But you create a section, you give it a name. I've given it the name vectors. You can actually call it a little bit what you want. And then we want to give the initial value to the step pointer. In this, right now we will set it to 0. Because we don't need it to be another value right now. And then we give it a handler for our reset exception. And here we have put in a simple stop. And plus 1. And plus 1 here, this is an ARM Cortex M3, and it runs an assembler instruction set called the thumb instruction set. So there are, on ARM processors, there are like a full ARM instruction set on some of them, and some of them can run the full set, and some of them can only can run only the subset called the thumb instruction set, which is a little bit simpler. I don't know exactly what restrictions you have in thumb, but on this particular processor, you only have thumb. And to show the processor that if you jump to this particular address in memory, you can expect to find thumb instructions, a way to signal that is to always end the address with 1. So if you wanted to jump to 10, you tell it 11. So it's just, that's the reason for the 1.
I have one more question just before you go on. So in you had two words here, so are those 4 long, or why did we have it in the first one on address 0 and the second one on address 4 in the previous slide?
They are 4 bytes each, yes.
Okay. address is also 4 bytes then, because the recent exception is an address later, or how does it work?
You mean what the maximum size of an address is?
Yeah.
I'm a bit unsure. The memory on this particular unit is not very big, so I haven't had to think about.
Okay. I think it's 32-bit.
Yeah.
It's not an ARM 64, and it's not.
No.
So then the maximum address is
I think it can only read on word aligned addresses. So the least valuable bits are always zero when the memory is read. That's why you can add one.
Yeah.
It doesn't care.
It doesn't. Okay.
Oh, okay. Thanks.
Okay, so we have a vector table written in assembler. Here we refer to another label called underscore start. And start will contain our actual program in assembler. And now we write it like this. We have our assembly code, as I showed you before. But we also have a label indicating where this is stored in memory. And also we tell assembler that we want to put this code in a section called text. So we have the vector in a section called vectors, and we have the code itself in a section called text. And then at the end we just do an infinite loop here. So what do we want to do here? We want to put our vector table right at the beginning of the flash memory, and after that we want to put our actual program somewhere, but we will put it right after the vector table. Okay, so now we have a list of prerequisites for our small minimalistic assembly program. We have already fulfilled some of them, but we are not quite there yet. So what have we done? We have a vector table, and we have a start address for the reset exception handler. We don't need any stack pointer in the vector table just yet, so we're done there. But we need to tell we need to put the vector table at address 0. And we also need to make sure the text section is positioned after the vectors. So we haven't done that yet, and now we look at that part. To do that, we need to use the linker. The linker can be controlled via linker script. And here is what it looks like. So what happens here? We can use the linker script to organize our different sections into the memory. So here is first, we say let's start at address 0, create an output section called text, and then you take all input sections called vectors, put them first, and then all input sections called text. So here we decide the order, and here we decide where in memory we want to start. And by doing that small linker script, we are done. We have fulfilled all the prerequisites for running this program. So let's compile it. And now, since this is an assembler program, we can use the GNU assembler. Compile it, and we only need a few flags, so we need to tell it what kind of processor, and I'm also telling it that I'm using the thumb instruction set, that what I was talking about, and I give it a instead of .c, I use .s for assembler files, and I define my output. And then in the next step, I use the linker with the linker script I showed you. I take the output from the compile step. I tell it what linker script do I want to use. named my link script on stm32.ld, and I tell the link, please use that one. And then I get an output file, and the output file is in a format called ELF. So here, that's like where my program ends up. But now we have a problem with this ELF file, because if we look at it, we use XXD to get a hex dump from it, and we just look at the beginning of the file. So let's see, what do we have there? We have, it says .elf. We were expecting to have our vector table there, right? Because we want to have a file that we can actually put on the device, and we want to look it exactly like that. We need to have a vector table at address 0. So we cannot use the ELF format here when we want to flash it onto the device. So one more. So what we need to do is we need to convert this ELF file into a raw binary file. And then we can use a GNU binary utility tool called objcopy. And what it will essentially do, in my understanding, is that it will throw away some extra information that we have in the ELF file, but it's not really a part of the core program. So all symbols and relocation information will be discarded, and the memory dump will start at the load address of the lowest section copied into the output file. So let's use that one. So we take object copy, and we use the ELF file as input. We tell it what kind of output format we want, and we create our binary file. Now we look at it again, and now it looks better. You can see here at the first row we have 000, so it's our initial stack pointer value, exactly set to 0 as we expected it to be. Then we expect to have the pointer to the reset exception handler here, and it's also correct because our start or our exception handler actually starts here with address 8, but we do plus 1, right? So it's 9, and the reason it's here is because of little endian, I think. So we use little endian here, so the least significant byte will be in the lowest memory address, I think. And that's why there is the 9 ends up here. And then we can start to look at the first instructions, and we can convert them from hexadecimal numbers into what they actually mean to see that they map with the program that we wrote. So we can see here, this is the first instruction, and it correlates to this one. This is the second, and then we add it together, and then we have a branch. And if you want to do this kind of conversion, you can look at section 1A7775 in the ARMv7N Architecture Reference Manual, or you can go to this homepage and page the 4X, and they will help you with it. So you have lots of options here.
Then number 0 in the branch.
Yes, I thought about that a little bit. I think it's the thing it's branching for is right after, but I'm not completely sure, because when it reaches here,
isn't it an offset of the instruction pointer?
I think it's like an infinite loop, so it's just jumping to itself.
Yeah, but is it a relative?
All these instructions have, all these assembly instructions, if you look in the manual, they always have like 10 different ways of doing it. So you can use relative jumps or active jumps, or there are always. But I think it's jumping basically to itself.
Because that was what you wrote.
Yeah, that's what I wrote.
So that's good.
Yeah. What happens?
So that's good.
What happens to the other exceptions which would be expected in where you have the program now?
Yeah.
So it will just execute here.
Like in this position, that if you do a proper reset vector table, I don't remember what's supposed to be in item 3, but there is some other exception. I think there is some error. And if that would happen, you would jump here, and it would try to jump to this address, and that wouldn't be valid, and you would be game over.
I see. Cool. Thanks.
So we don't have it. Okay, yes. So we have our program, but we want to verify it. Right? We want to know it works. So now, in order to do that, we want to use some kind of device to get it onto the device. So this is what we're going to use. We're going to use something called OpenOCD. And it works like that. You run something called an OpenOCD server on your PC. It connects to a VTag adapter. In this case, I bought it from Olimex. It's called like that. You can see it here. I will show you a picture also. And then this one you connect to the target itself. So this is my arm cortex, and I connect it with the cable, and the cable comes here. This is my flashing device or VTag device, and then I connect the USB back to my computer. And then in order to flash, first I need to start the server on my machine. So I open a terminal, I start OpenOCD, then I have my server. Then in order to communicate it, that it opens two sockets for me locally on my machine. So I can connect to it with Telnet on 4444. That's what I'm going to do now, and later we will use the debugger, GDB, and we will connect on port 3333. But now we want to flash, and then this is what we're going to do. With Telnet to it, we tell it to halt whatever is going on. Then we erase the flash and we write our add.bin program to it. And then we say run, go. But then we want to, of course, see what happens. And then we halt it again and we say please. And this is my Telnet session. I'm going on here in my Telnet session. And I say ring. And it will print out all the register values. And then I can see that R2 and R3 contains 3 and 4, and the sum is put in R4. So based on that, I'm thinking my program has executed. So I'm happy. Okay, so that was our assembler program. We have written it, we have written a minimalistic linker script, we have run compiled it, we have run it, we have verified it that it seems to run. Everything is. Then we can go back to our C program that we wanted to run. So what does it really look like? It's similar to our assembler program. We have two variables, A and B, that we give values, and then we, in the program itself, we sum them up and store them in sum. And as you can see, the variables itself are a bit different declared, because this will lead to different requirements on them. So this is what we're going to go through. So the first step that we're going to do here is that we will use GCC, but we will not. We don't want to compile all the way to binary code. We just want to generate the assembly code for us, so we can look at that. So then we'll use the S flag, and this is from the documentation. It says, stop after the stage of compilation proper. Do not assemble. The output is in the form of assembler code file for each non-assembler input file specified. Yes, this is what we want. But we need to tell it what kind of processor we have. So we use the same flags here as we used when we compiled the assembler program. starting from the top. No, we won't try it like that. I have some more slides for you. So the goal right now is that we have this empty list of prerequisites. So we'll go through the assembly code and we will add prerequisites one by one here. So if we just take this whole program and we just divide it into what are the big sections here, that I won't go through each instruction one by one. I will highlight what I think is important for you. So let's start. We have the blue section. And the blue section is corresponds to where we declare and define our variables. And then we have the yellow section, which actually corresponds to the main function itself. So we will start with the blue section, and then we'll go to the yellow section. And at the beginning there, you have some assembly directives, they are called. But I really won't go through them. They have to do with something called the embedded ABI interface, which I'm not very familiar with. But they set up some configuration for that. But I won't go through that because I don't need to configure it in order to run. It doesn't affect my linker script or something. So. We define A, B, and the sum variables. And we will, now we can divide it like that also, to make it clear what belongs to the different variables. So we'll start looking at A. So this is a static variable, and static in C means that it's file scope. So this variable is only available in this particular file, not in other C files. So it's a file scope variable. And it's const, so it's read-only, and it's an integer. So, what kind of assembly directives do we have here? We have the section that we had before. The compiler wants to put this particular variable in a section called RO data, read-only data, which makes sense because it's a const. It wants to align it, and then it tells assembly that it's a type of object, that A is of object type. It can be either a function type on this address, or this particular label here can be a function label or an object label. And then we tell it it's 4 bytes. We give it a label, and we tell it the value to store there. But what is really important, what is important for us here and really to know them? Yeah, this is important. This is a requirement for us that we need to know. So we put it down in our table. We need to make the immutable data in the raw data section available in the read-only memory. Because this is expected. When we power on the device, the program will only function if this data is there. So then we move on. Variable B is very similar, but there's one important difference. It's not const, so it's put in another section. It's put in the data section. Data section. So we add it to our list. We need to make the mutable data this time. Available in the data section. We need to make the mutable data in the data section available in the read-write memory, so not in the read-only memory. These are prerequisites that needs to be in place at the time we start to execute our C program that we are working with. All this needs to be in place at that moment in time. It expects this this variable to be there in the read-only. Then we go to the last variable, it's sum.
A question.
Yes.
If you go back one step, at the top it says dot section dot RO data, but in the next one it for B, it only says data.
Yeah.
Where's the section keyword?
Yeah, my understanding about that is that section, then you can come up with any name you want for the section name.
Yeah.
But here, for some very typical section names, they have like shortcuts.
Right.
Like you don't have to write dot section data because everyone uses data, so you can't write dot the data. So it's just a shortcut of writing dot section dot data. Mm-hmm. So let's look at sum. What's special about sum compared to the other two is that we don't initialize it. So it's uninitialized here by us in the C code. And that also has a consequence because uninitialized data will, with file scope, will end up in the DSS section. And that puts a new requirement on us. We need to make the DSS section available in the read-write memory because it's not a const. It also needs to be in the read-write memory. Also, and this is an additional requirement that actually can't be seen from our code, also make sure all memory in the DSS section is initialized to zero. And from where did I get that requirement? I got it from the C99 ISO standard, page 138, paragraph 10. If you read it here, if an object that has static store iteration is not initialized explicitly, then if it has arithmetic type, it's initialized to zero. So then I think we must make sure, as a promise, before we start to execute this program, that this memory section has been initialized by us before the program starts. Okay, so we have gone through the blue section and we have come up with some requirements based on that. Are you following me? Yeah. Then I will go on to the yellow section, which is the main function itself. So it looks like this. We have some for example, we put it in the text section. We align it. This symbol name is global, so it's seen outside this file. This declarative syntax unified, not really sure what it means. It's something with what kind of assembler version we're using, but it seems like nowadays we only use this one, and it was a long time ago they used something else. So. Yeah, I don't really know what you can put there instead. It's like, yeah, for some historic reason we need to have this, but for you it's not really an option. So, and then we get if we want to have thumb instruction set. We don't have a floating point unit on this processor, so we tell it to use soft floating point, which is not interesting in this program because I'm not doing floating point calculations. And this label here is of type function instead of object. That we had before when we were declaring variables. And then my program starts. And we will. So I just quickly explained that, but it doesn't actually lead to any interesting requirement for us right now. So we will look here in more detail and see if we can come up with some requirements that we need to know. So I show you now what belongs really to different parts of the function. So actually the first two lines they are not part of the code itself, but they happen at the start of the function. Now what happens here? What happens is that we have the C code expects there to be a stack. So somewhere in the memory, it expects us to have a stack allocated, and what it can do with a stack is that you can push things onto the stack, and you always have a pointer pointing to the last item in the stack, and then you can pop things off the stack again. And what is stored in the R7 register when we enter the function, that's like some, in this particular program, we only have one function, right? But in normal programs, you have many functions, and they are calling each other. So when one function is calling another function, when we enter this function, what we know is that when we finish this function, the function that called us expects us to return the stack pointer to the position shown by the R7 register. So we start, I imagine a big program working like this. You start with nothing in stack, and then you build up the stack, and you nest in a lot of functions. You call that function, that function, that function, and you add stuff in each function. But when each function finish, it needs to jump back to one where it was when it was called. So this is sort of the contract between the functions, that the function that's calling my function expects me to put the stack pointer back to the value here. So in order to remember that value, the main function is just putting that value onto the stack. And then it stores its own start value into the R7 register. Like, where did I start with stack pointer? Where was I when I started executing? Then we run the code itself. And this code actually equals sum equal to A plus B. I don't think I will go through that in detail, but this code here equals that, but it won't actually lead to any requirement on our linker script or something like that. And then in the end, we have to make sure the stack pointer goes back to where it was. So we load the stack pointer with the value in the R7 that corresponds to our add instruction there, and then we pop out the R7 value again from the stack into the R7 register. So the situation is back to where it was when we were called. And this whole thing is not very important in this minimalistic program, really. But it shows that the program expects the stack to be set up. But it's more important when you have a nested, you call many functions. And then at the end, we just jump back to where the link register wants us to jump back. So in a big program, this link register would show the address where we were when we were called. From somewhere, and now when we are finished, we want to jump back to where we were and continue executing there. So these are the different assembler instructions we have on this page. All these instructions that I highlight expect there to be a stack setup. If there is no stack setup, these won't work. So If I read the programming manual for the process, it says about the push and pop instructions, for example. Push registers onto and pop registers off a full descending stack. So what this means is we need to initialize the stack pointer. In the assembler case, we got away with letting it be zero in the vector table. But now, in order for this push and pop instructions to actually execute correctly, they must be pointing to some valid memory here. So I add it to our requirement list. Okay, so we have made a list of requirements for our C program, and then we had our own list of requirements for our minimalistic assembler program, and now I merged them into one list, because actually in order to run my C program, I have to fulfill the requirements I have for my assembler program. So the full list of requirements looks like this. We need to have an empty table with a start address for the what happens at reset. We will need to put the vector table right at the beginning of flash, and then we need to put the text section after the vector table in flash. Then, additionally, to run the C code, we need to make the immutable data in the read-only data section available in the read-only memory. We need to make the mutable data in the data section available in the read-write memory. And we need to make the DSS section available in the read-write memory as well. In addition, we need to initialize that memory to zero. And we need to set up the stack pointer. These whole requirements can be visualized with this picture. So this picture corresponds to these requirements. So this is what we want the memory to look like when we start to execute the program. We need to put vectors at the top. After that, we want to put the text section. After that, we want to have the read-only data. And then we put the data in flash. And then when we jump to RAM, we also want to have the data there, as you can see, at runtime. We will discuss that more. And then we have variable sum, it's in the DSS section. And then after all those sections,